Today and welcome back. We'll talk about atomic structure. This video will include about the Bose model and the line spectrum. First of all, we talk about Bose postulate. There are two points here. First is the electron revolve about the nucleus of atom only in certain orbits. The angular momentum with the symbol L is given as nh over 2 pi, where n is the n orbit of the atom, and this formula will be used again later on. Second is about the emission of electromagnetic radiation with specific frequency when there is transition of electron from higher to lower energy state. So basically, we have atom with the electron in the ground state, which is the lowest energy state at normal occasion. At certain condition, can supply energy to the electron to transit to higher energy, but eventually it will fall back to the ground state due to stability, as what we have learned about in the chemistry. For this case, electromagnetic radiation will be emitted in the form of photon with specific frequency based on the difference between the energy state, for example, E2 minus E1 for this diagram. We move on to formula derivation. The concept we are talking here is about the revolution of electron around a nucleus. There's electrostatic force between the nucleus and the electron, which act as the centripetal force for the circular motion of electron around the nucleus. Quite similar to gravitation concept we have learned in the first semester. So here we have the equation of Zee over 4 pi epsilon r squared equal to mv squared over r, where Ze is the charge of nucleus. It depends on which atom we are talking about, for example, like the hydrogen atom, which has one positive charge in its nucleus. Another equation we are going to use here is from Bose postulate that the angular momentum, which also can be expressed as mvr equal to nh over 2 pi. So here we have two equations where there are two variables that are not constant. They are the velocity of electron and the radius of orbit. Our goal here is to derive the radius of orbit, so we can do simultaneous and eliminate the velocity from the equation. So here I just briefly go through, since some of you may do it differently. Here I will start from second equation to get the expression of velocity, which is nh over 2 pi mr. Then we can substitute into the first equation that we can do simplification and obtain the expression of radius is equal to epsilon n squared h squared over pi m z e squared. In short, you can see the radius of orbits is proportional to the square of n. There is a term called Bose radius, which is the smallest radius can be found, and it is the first orbit in hydrogen atom that n equal to 1 and z equal to 1. It is approximately 0.053 nanometer and often used as the fundamental length to compare with other orbits of hydrogen atom or other atoms as well. By referring to Bose radius, we can express other orbits in a simpler way. For example, the second orbit of hydrogen atom is 4R1, third orbit is 9R1, and so on. We shall move on to the energy. The revolution of electron involves kinetic energy, or the attraction between the nucleus and electron give electric potential energy. So the total energy of an electron in certain orbit is the combination of these two energy. So the kinetic energy, as usual, expressed as half mv squared, while u is the same as what we did just now. The next step is to simplify the equation. Think back the first equation in the previous slide. We have the electrostatic force as the centripetal force. Here you can pay attention to the mv squared and rearrange the equation. You can replace the mv squared as ze squared over 4 pi epsilon r, which has the same expression as the electric potential energy. So in simple, we have half u minus u, so we have negative half u, which is equal to negative ze squared over 8 pi epsilon r. So once again, we don't want something that is not constant variable in our equation. We're going to replace the radius using the equation derived. Finally, we have the energy is equal to negative z squared e to the power 4m divided by f epsilon squared h squared n squared. So this is the expression of energy level depend on the value of n and z. For hydrogen atom, we have z equal to 1 and we can put in all the constant value. For the first orbit of hydrogen atom, it is negative 13.6 eV, while others can be expressed as negative 1 over n squared multiplied the energy level of first orbit. So we have finished the formula derivation. Now we're going to talk about excitation and also ionization energy. Basically, excitation energy is the energy required to excite the electron to higher energy state, while the ionization energy is the energy required to ionize the atom, which is the minimal energy to free the electron from the atom. Based on the formula derived, we can roughly sketch the energy level diagram. So this is specific for a hydrogen atom that the ground state has the energy level of negative 13.6 eV, while others can be calculated using the formula we have just now. The excitation energy depends which level the electron transit to. We can calculate the energy required simply by final minus the initial energy level. For ionization energy, it is the energy needed to fully escape from atom. It will be equal to negative E1. So there's something you can note here. Ionization energy talks about the minimum energy required to free the electron, which is something similar to the work function that we have discussed in the previous topic. They are quite familiar, except that they are used for different situations. Work function refers to the energy required to release the electron in a metal, but for ionization energy, it is to release the electron from an atom. So here we also can supply more energy than the ionization energy to the electron, that the remaining energy will become the kinetic energy of the free electron. Before we move on, we can take note that there are two ways to excite the electron or ionize the atom, which include absorption of photon and by collision. Now, let's discuss a few questions to talk about it. First is from the past year in 2017. This is the energy level diagram for hydrogen atom. What will happen to the photon of energies 12 eV and 10.2 eV when they pass through a stable state atomic hydrogen bubble? So you need to remind yourself that photon is discrete light energy package. It is a discrete package that you can only either take it as a whole or not to do anything about it. Before that, let's calculate the difference between energy levels. One is from the ground state to the first excited state, which required 10.2 eV. Next is from the ground to the second excited state that equal to 12.09 eV. Now, what will happen? First, the 10.2 eV photon can be absorbed completely by the electron to transit to the second orbit. The energy is just enough, not more or less than the required amount. For 12 eV, it cannot excite the electron to the second orbit because it cannot be absorbed partially, and also that the electron could not store the remaining 1.8 eV energy. The 12 eV energy also not enough to excite to the third orbit, so nothing will happen to the photon in this case. Now, we move on to a question from College Tingkatan Anam Petaling Jaya in 2021. Here is showing the energy level of another atom. Let's calculate the energy required first. From the first to second orbit, we'll need 4.9 eV, and then from the first to the third orbit, we'll need 6.7 eV. This time is about the collision with another electron with kinetic energy of 5.4 eV. So after the collision, part of the kinetic energy can be transferred to excite the electron in the atom, while the rest of energy will be carried by the electron. So this is something different compared to the case of photon, where we do not need the kinetic energy of the electron to be exactly the same as the excitation energy needed. Until this part, there's something I would like to comment is that the collision here is actually inelastic collision since the kinetic energy is not conserved. So the electron of mercury atom will only absorb the energy of 4.9 eV for the excitation, and the kinetic energy of the colliding atom left 0.5 eV. To find out the possible frequency of photon, that when the electron back to the ground state. So we'll take the 4.9 eV, which is the difference between E2 and E1 to calculate the frequency of photon emitted. This will give us the frequency of 1.18 times 10 to the power of 15 Hz. Now, let's explore further about this case. What if we have another electron with kinetic energy more than 6.7 eV, let's say 7 eV. So there will be two possibilities that the electron will excite to either the first excited state or second excited state. These are two possible cases which bring us three possible frequencies of photon. First is when the electron is excited to first excited state, which is the same as what we have discussed. Second is when the electron is excited to second excited state, so the electron might drop to ground state directly, or it may drop to the first excited state first before the ground state. Hence, we have three possible frequencies of the photon if the kinetic energy is about 7 eV in this case. So the last thing is about the emission line spectra, which we refer to hydrogen atom to conclude this topic. The electron is actually not stable when it is excited. It will eventually drop to ground state and emit electromagnetic radiation, where frequency is proportional to the difference between energy levels of transition. The emission of electromagnetic radiation can be categorized into a few series, which depends on which state is the electron transit to. For electron that transit from any high level to the ground state, the frequency of photon emitted is in the range of ultraviolet, and those transitions are categorized as Lehmann series. For those electrons that transit to first excited state where n equal to 2, it is in visible light range and it is categorized as Balmer series. For second excited state, it will be infrared range and it is Pastern series. So that's all for my discussion today. If you still have any question, leave it in the comment section below. Thank you.